Well, hello, my name is Abena Ocran-Jackson. I am the Vice President of Credentialing here at the Council for Professional Recognition. What does that really mean? I oversee a number of our programmatic units within the Council, starting with our credentialing, our training and development team that oversees our specialists, professional development specialists and gold standard specialists. I also oversee our unit that handles multilingual and special projects. I oversee the team that also handles our annual conference, our EELC, our alumni, and also the unit that handles our learning management system. And so, you know, for me, I'm very excited to be here with Dr. Cindy Shackelford. And I'm going to allow her to introduce herself in a minute. But I have been in the field of early childhood for about 25 years, starting with, you know, majoring in early childhood education. I worked for NAEYC for a number of years. I worked for KinderCare Education for a number of years. And now I am here with the council. I'm very excited about the mission and vision of the council. So Dr. Shackelford, can you introduce yourself?
Absolutely, Abena. Thank you so much for having me. It's such an honor to be here with you today. So I bring you all of you greetings from Birmingham, Alabama. My name is Dr. Cindy Shackelford. I currently serve as the chair and program coordinator for the child development program, as well as serving early childhood education and elementary education majors at Jefferson State Community College. We are the largest community college in the state of Alabama. We have four campuses statewide, and our mission is to equip students to be fully ready to go out into the classroom and serve children and families in the field, specifically focusing on child development and early childhood education, which is our root. Like Abena, my number of years in the field, I think we're approaching in August, it'll be about 26, I think. I came right out of high school, hired as a preschool teacher, knew nothing right out of high school, but I was in love with early childhood at the age of five. It was then that my warm and fuzzy started with my kindergarten teacher, and that was what I wanted to do, to teach. And so from teaching preschool, I was able to get my CDA credentials through the preschool where I was teaching, and it was from there that it just continued to grow through my studies at UAB, and then from there, I just had the desire to continue to learn as much as I could in the field, so I could not stop there. So here I am on the other side now, equipping students who are about to be educators in the field, and also those who are currently educators, giving them additional knowledge as well. We're all students every day. I believe in continuously learning so that I can just impact along with awesome team members. I don't do this alone, but I believe in impacting the world as much as we can with whomever we can touch to ensure quality teaching and learning in our schools, child development centers, and preschool programs. So I'm just honored to be here.
Well, great. I'm so excited about our conversation. Today, we're speaking about one of my favorite functional areas, which is professionalism. But before we dive in, and you stated a little bit of this in your introduction, we would love to hear what really led you into early childhood education field and what inspires you to continue to move the field forward now.
So again, I remember being 5 years of age. I believe that every intentional educator is sparked by another intentional educator. We can say we want to teach, but there has to have been an experience that set that up for us to connect us to say, I want to do that. It can be a feeling, it could be an observation, it could be a success that we've accomplished that makes us say we want to do the same. For me, it was all of those. In addition to the fact that my family is a family of educators, not all of them, but my mother, my dad, you know, these are people that are significant in my life that I know will have taught. They're retired now, but I have had the blessing to be connected to not just my family, but inspiring mentors and women in my life and men in my life that have really given me the tools that I need to be equipped to desire to continue in the field. When I was 18, I knew when I was coming out of high school what I was going to major in. There was no doubt it was going to be early childhood education with also, believe it or not, a double major in dance. So that's another story. But I do believe that our purposes are set for us before we're born. And so it was very clear that I would be connected to both of these in my life. And so it was that moment when I went to my first class at UAB and at Jefferson State, believe it or not, I was doing two campuses, going to one for a bachelor's and one for a CDA. And it was the professor at Jefferson State that literally said, there are some that have it and there are some that don't, and some will learn it. You already have it. So all you need to do is just continue to grow in the skill set and understand the root of it. At the time, I did not know what she meant. Little also did I know I would take her seat. You know, 20 years later, you know, I did not know that, but she saw something that at the time I was still evolving into that. I did not quite understand, but it was through those experiences between the people that have inspired me, but also just what I have seen in our communities, what we see on TV, what we read about, what we research about. It is clear that there is a continuing need for quality teaching and learning in our birth to five age group. And if you want to even expand it to our birth to eight age group, but we know in our kindergarten through third grade age groups, there's more of a set standard of what it has to be anyway, in order for them to even just begin. Whereas birth to five, the standard is viewed as optional. And I believe that is where the gap falls in why we have still facilities that don't have the quality teaching and learning that we should see. And let me also say quality leadership. Leadership sets the culture for what the teachers will do. And this is all the way up to 12th grade and even in higher ed. As chair, I set the culture for what my faculty will do. And so there's an accountability on us as leadership as well. But when we talk about the ones that have direct access to these children birth to five, what has inspired me is to continue to learn as much as I can, to be able to pour that back into them, because they're the ones that are going to affect those children directly, whereas my connection is indirect because they're basing it off of what they were told or what experiences they were given or what quality practicum experiences they received that equipped them to say, I am now ready to go into the classroom and be an effective teacher, or like I always like to say, intentional educator.
Thank you. That is wonderful. And I think, you know, our stories are similar, except for the higher ed part. I haven't gotten to that part yet, but just the passion of where it all started. Because for me, it also started at a young age, it going into high school and then determining that I wanted to work with kids. I wasn't sure on what level. So I actually started college as pre-med and very quickly realized, because my father was a doctor, very quickly realized that pre-med was not for me. But early childhood, just that passion that you speak about, was there and had been there. And that drove me straight into human development, early childhood concentration. I actually have a minor in special education. So that passion, like you said, you know, just is within you, and it's just trying to figure out, you know, the direction of, you know, which way to go. So Dr. Shackelford, from being a professional development specialist to a professor, to a department chair, you've taken inspiring professional strides in your field. What sparked your ambition to move into academia? And how do you view your work and college students fitting into your vision and the hopes for early childhood education across the nation and the world?
I think it goes back to what I was previously talking about, wanting to be sure that I continue to know everything that I can about the field to be as effective as I can in the field. I'm very grateful to say that before I crossed into higher ed, I had served on all elements of the field. I've been the teacher, but I'm also working in child development. I've been the cook. I had to drive the bus to pick up the kids from after school care as a director. You know, as a director, you do it all. I've sprayed the playground, you know, I've picked up the bird poop. I've done it all, you know, and I think that's all well and great, but there are still more evolving things that are taking place in the field of early childhood education and child development specifically. Mm-hmm. Then in order for me to be effective, I need to continue to grow into the field and knowledge of it. No matter how much I know today, I have a million miles to go before I know it all. And so therefore I will never know it all. So my accountability is just to continue to learn. And so that is what sparked me when I finished my first degree. You know, I think it's common for some of us to say, well, I'll get my master's now. But I wasn't content. I felt as though there needed to be more. So I pursued an additional bachelor's degree. And then I was like, I know that I need to learn more. I need to learn more. I need to learn more. So I got my master's and I was like, no. There's more. There is more. I'm not effective until I know everything that we're to the point to where the college says, you can't come here anymore. There isn't anything else for you to obtain in this particular focus that you're focusing on. Right. And so it was just the desire to just know as much as I can. I continue to train. I mean, even now, believe it or not, I just finished my second doctorate in April. Again, I love school. I love everything connected to it. And I want to just be as effective as I can to reach every student where they are. Mm-hmm. Every future educator where they are, every current educator where they are, to be able to speak to all pieces of it. But how can I do that if I don't know myself? So I think that was the spark for me. And I think that a part of the way that I serve today, because this is a service field, when I serve these students, when I serve these teachers, when I serve these directors, it is my responsibility to find out what their goals are. What exactly are you wanting to do in the field? Everything is not just about being in the classroom, as you and I know, because we started there, but that's not where we are today. This field is connected to millions of opportunities. The question is, what are your short and long-term goals? And I'm accountable in higher education, along with my awesome faculty and education specialists, to help them to meet those goals by setting up a plan that works for them. No longer in higher education are we doing parent conferences and all of those things. This is accountability as an adult learner. Tell me about your goals. It is my responsibility to help you meet that. So I don't really like to say that you must fit into my vision, because what I decided to do for me to be fully equipped is not necessarily what everyone has to do. Right. It is literally about your personal goals and what you're wanting to achieve. So if someone said to me, Dr. Shackelford, I desire to pursue higher education to serve as a dean of a university, you know, then I will tell them up front, you're going to need to have a doctorate degree. You know, these are conversations that we're having so that we can make sure we're putting them on the track that works for them. But my inspiration is my own because it's connected to my personal goals, but it also is connected to how it will help other people. So the achievements that I have are never about me. It's never about me. It's always about, okay, now how can I better serve you because I know this now versus what I didn't know, say, 10 years ago. You know, how can I better serve you in this particular way, contingent upon, you know, your needs?
Thank you. Congratulations on your second doctorate. But I absolutely agree with you when you spoke about the passion and the vision. Because regardless of whether you're in the classroom or not in the classroom and supporting administrative role, it is about your vision. It's about the passion and how you want to either directly support the children and the families in the community or those educators who are supporting the children and family. So, you know, thank you for that. I absolutely love it. As we begin to think about professionalism in early childhood education, the importance of reflection seems like a great place to start. So for the essentials for working with children, it provides a great suggestions on cultivating reflective practices, like maintaining a diary, asking a colleague to observe you, teaching and providing feedback, even asking children for their feedback. And we know they are completely honest with us in the classroom. How do you think reflection can help teachers grow? And what advice do you have for getting into the habit of intentional reflection?
Well, Abena, that is such an awesome question, because self-reflection is a part of my daily routine. It is something that I address with any student that has had me on the higher ed side and even the high school side for our dual enrollment students. Every student that has had me will tell you that I always talk about self-reflection. I mean, I feel like I can show this. I know we're live, but I have several documents. This is actually my self-reflection book. This is probably my, fourth, fifth one, probably in the last couple of months, because I write that much.
Oh, wow.
And there are several others here that are busted and old, but tisk. I believe that in order for us to be intentional, we have to self-reflect every day. And we have to self-reflect on three key areas. And when I say that, I mean at the end of the day. And I do it at the end of the day for me, because you don't necessarily know what you're going into the next day. You may have a schedule. Like, I can look at my calendar and say, you know, I have this today, I have this tomorrow, but I don't necessarily know what type of engagement will happen in those planned moments. And so as a teacher, we can have our lesson plans and we have our theme for the week and we have our materials ready and we know what we're going to do with the children, or shall we say, we think we know what we're going to do with the children. And you have these ideas ready to go and you're super excited about what you have decided to do, only to find that this does not necessarily work the way you thought it would due to something you missed or something you didn't think about. Or, you know, it may even be on just the, when we talk about training, understanding about exceptionalities. Do you have accommodations in your lesson plan? Sometimes as educators, you know, we plan these events and we don't think about accommodations. Accommodations must be included in everything we plan to accommodate the diversities of learning. We talk about our diversities in culture, that's automatic, but what about the diversities of learning? That should be thought about in everything that we plan for anyone. And so the three key areas that I always tell teachers, leadership, myself, you know, my faculty, my team, you need to reflect daily on what worked and how did you play a role in that? What did not work and how did you play a role in that? And what could have been better and how did you play a role in that? We often will complain about what didn't work, what we didn't like, and I didn't like how it went this way, but did you have anything to do with that? You know, or we talk about it should have gone this way. Okay, did you think about that in the moment or did this just happen? You know, you reflect on those things because it's almost like a memory bank where you can go back and say, now I do recall doing this before. Okay, duly noted, it did not work. So we will try, we will not do it that way, you know, based upon, you know, my notes. And so I don't believe that you can grow if you don't self-reflect. I don't believe that that's possible. Reflection, feedback is critical. Good, bad, and ugly is necessary, because just because you have it presented in a way that you feel is presentable doesn't mean that it works for everyone receiving the information. It's the receivers that have to benefit, not the one presenting. You're giving, but does it work for them? We're at a restaurant and a waitress comes to the table and I ask for water and you bring me Coca-Cola and I don't drink Coca-Cola, you may have brought it very nicely to me. Here you go, ma'am. However, I said water. So therefore, I am not benefiting by the way you're presenting what I asked for. And so there's accountability in the classroom with that. And I think that we grow by reflecting on each day to think about the next day and how we'll present information to be accountable. And sometimes it's not just about the children. It's also in our engagement with our families too. Information that we're sending to them via newsletters or daily sheets, you know, and information that the parents are receiving. And we have to look at, you know, are they really understanding this information? Do I need to modify this information to make sure it's understood to accommodate all different types of parents? Or is it just a one-way approach? So self-reflection is a huge part of my life. I have always done that. I always say we have not arrived until we cannot do it anymore. And I don't think I need to go into details of what I mean by we cannot do it anymore. Because when I say do it anymore, I mean do anything anymore. So until then, we have more to learn and reflect upon to be better the next day and help us to grow. I really believe it's a huge part of how I even got to this point in my career. By reflecting on what worked and what did not work and what could be better, it helped in how I serve in the leadership role today versus how I served as a leader 10 years ago.
Sure. That's great. I love the three questions that you posed in terms of people reflecting. I think also it's around the intentionality of reflection mm-hmm. and being able to receive and also give reflection or feedback because you have to always worry about how you're sharing the feedback and how somebody is receiving that. And that's something within my career that I've worked, you know, very hard on also in terms of just being a good receptive person. And so taking that feedback in, I can go in my little corner and whine or be upset for about 5 minutes, but then being able to process, say, okay, what are the next steps? What am I going to do to change the feedback? And also, you know, the compliments and not letting that, you know, take over and say, well, this was a good moment, you know, as you stated. And so I want to make sure that I build on aspects of that moving forward. So Dr. Shackelford, Essentials tells us that teachers and providers who regularly practice reflection find that it also helps them uncover hidden biases and dispositions. What examples of this have you seen in your work as an educator of early education for teachers and providers? And how do you see reflective practices really helping teachers make those ethical and equitable decisions?
I think this goes back to that daily self-reflection connected to your intentional practices when you decide what you're going to do in the classroom. I think for some educators, there is a connection to a gap in not knowing about those biases up front, that's even a bias. You know, when I talk to some teachers and even students who are currently teaching in the field that are getting their education, they reveal that they were not aware that there was even a such thing as a bias regarding exceptionalities or even choosing a theme. For example, I've seen where students will submit lesson plans and say it's during our fall semester, and a student will submit a lesson plan and say, what I've chosen to focus on, Dr. Shackelford, is Santa Claus. It's Merry Christmas. It's Santa Claus all week. It's Santa Claus cookies. It's Santa Claus wear red, wear your Christmas hat. And Santa Claus, and Santa Claus. And what they realize is like, now you're basically saying, if you don't acknowledge Santa Claus, then you are not a part of this group. And they don't realize is they're so excited about it because that's their stuff. That's your childhood stuff you're trying to bring into this place because you love Santa Claus. That's right. Your relationship with him, you know? And so you want to bring in Santa Claus because it's December, so it's Santa Claus, not realizing that you have cultures in your classroom that don't acknowledge that. You are literally creating a bias when you say you know, we are just doing Santa Claus. What about the people that celebrate it differently? Have you even done an assessment of your families to talk about their culture and what they do during mealtimes and how they celebrate holidays? And I don't fault them for that at all, because that's something that I don't want to say I had to learn it, but I never did that. I never did the Santa Claus thing in the classroom like that. I never did that. But I will say that it was through education and training that I had to learn that when you do things like that, you are basically saying that this is us and you are over there. You know, Halloween is another one. I've seen teachers that will submit lesson plans talking about Halloween and not realizing that everyone in your class doesn't dress up and do that. And so you'll say, we're having a costume party. And I've observed where a teacher told a parent, your child will be left out. What's your plan? You know, and it's like, oh no. Like, and I'm observing in the moment, so I can't engage, but the inner me was like, don't tell her that. But she literally said that, you know, we're having a costume party. The parent said, you know, we don't celebrate Halloween. Well, we're dressing up for Halloween. Your child's going to be left out. What's your plan? Just in the same tone you just heard me say, that's what she got. And so my inner person was just, oh, that just hurt me to the core. But she had no clue. So instead of me addressing the teacher, I had to go to the leadership. And I found that the leadership didn't know that that was an issue. The leadership is the one that told them, we're going to do a costume party in all the classrooms. Tell your parents on this day. So there is a connection, again, going back to the culture that's being set. When we talk about making decisions that don't exclude, every child should be included. Inclusion from their family dynamic all the way down to what they do in certain things. And no, you can't acknowledge everything they do in their culture. But when we talk about certain cultures and certain things that we do in the classroom, you need to take that into consideration. And I think from my observation, for some, it's just being unaware, but they don't reflect on that too. They're not aware about the self-reflection piece that tells them, okay, last year, or fall of 2019, I learned that telling a parent that we're having a costume party for Halloween basically creates some type of prejudice or bias against them if they don't. Prior to that, I did not know. So how can I change that for this fall? I know what we can do. We can just celebrate the fall. Why? Because that's reality. The fall is here. You can't do anything about that. Doesn't matter what your cultures are. It's fall outside. So we're having a fall party. We're going to go and collect leaves. We're going to make leaf paintings. We're going to have orange cookies because leaves are orange. You know, our color of the week is orange. You know, we're going to wear orange, brown, or red, you know, whichever color you want to celebrate the fall. Now everyone is included. No one feels left out because of what they do in their homes. I think ethically, we have to also respect that too. That's hard for some educators to respect the different cultures in their classroom. Because again, if you have been trained to believe that it's one way, then that is exactly what you will do. So again, no fault of their own. But when you start to become educated in the field of birth to five of child development, now you're held accountable because now you know better. You don't get to say, well, you know, I've been teaching children for 30 years. My analogy to that is very simple. If a baker tells me, I've been baking for 30 years, I have been trained to bake cakes for 30 years. Okay, that's all great. But if no one ever told the baker that salt, sugar, and flour, while all three of those are white, they have to be used differently. No one ever told you that. So your cakes look beautiful. They're beautiful cakes, but they taste horrible. Therefore, the ones that we sometimes will meet in this field that will, you know, that may be, you know, they could be older than me and, you know, oh, little girl, I've been teaching before you were born. This is probably true. However, your practices do not line up with what we deem as developmentally appropriate. Mm-hmm. And this is when we start to find that they've never been addressed about such, because it was just about the minimal. It was never about the high quality that we could ensure that these children give, even in the infant classroom. And I think that the part of that that stirs me up is to continue to provide this information to our child development programs, teachers, directors, students, going out into the field, traveling to different facilities, providing free professional development to their facilities, just to ensure that someone is saying something to you and not just leaving you here in the corner because of the neighborhood that you're in or because you're over here and no one knew you even existed. I'm responsible for going out there because I know you sit there. And I know that someone's babies are coming through there, whether it may not be my own babies, but that someone's children coming through that facility. We need to ensure that they have the information that they need to be quality teachers. One of the things that I always like that Dr. Moore says, you know, the CDA is not the final step, but it's the best first step. And he is so correct because you build upon that, but it's a start. It's something that you can at least say, I at least understand when we talk about the basic principles and milestones in development of child development, theoretical understandings of theorists and things that we can apply to help us understand about the type of educator that I want to be. Who am I in the lives of children? Who am I? And not just who am I today, who do I aspire to be if I'm not meeting that today? And so it's so deep when you get to put eyes on that. And when you are accountable for what you know, and are you holding that in, or are you sharing that with a limited group, or are you sharing that with everyone? So that is something I could also talk about forever.
Well, thank you. So CDA candidates learn that confidence is a big part of professionalism. Particularly confidence in their ability to explain best practices, which can designate you as the voice of your setting and of early childhood education to the community. What advice do you have for early educators who are struggling with this type of confidence, particularly those who want to become vocal advocates for the children that they teach and the families that they support?
So I think there's a twofold to that. Let me first start with where they're employed, because again, it starts with your leadership. Your leadership has to create these opportunities where information is shared and given to our children and families, more so when we talk about our families and communities, where that information informs them of the roots of the why. What's your why? Why do we teach this way? Why do we implement these strategies? Why do we focus on this mission and philosophy for what we do? I think that how the information is given, when we connect it back to assessments, when we talk about anecdotal records, when we talk about portfolios, you have some facilities that don't have that. And so they're limited in their ability to advocate for what they do and why they do. When you start going into the element of assessments, that creates a platform for you to speak to your why and advocate for what needs to be done, because you have an assessment tool or document that supports what you're saying. You have research that supports what you're saying. You have evidence in your classroom and information that you can share with your families that supports what you're saying, for your why, for your reason for how you teach, or why you teach the way that you do. Outside of your place of employment, even if you're not, I always urge, I always want to say force my students to join at least one professional organization. I don't get into a specific of my preference or what they need to do, but I do tell them they have to join at least one, because in doing so, that is going to connect them to other advocates. It's going to connect them to other leaders that speak to that, and also will spark in them, in their own time, the desire to be ready to at least try. You have to start somewhere. I don't think it's something that you just, I would like to advocate, starting tomorrow, that's what you'll do. No, it is something that grows within us, you know, because again, you know, going back to when I first started teaching, I was just focused on just teaching and teaching the right way. I did not realize that I was already advocating then, you know, and what I was telling these parents and how it grew into where it is today. And so I think that it's inner and outer. There's some intentional steps that have to be taken outside of your place of employment, because your leadership may not necessarily require for you to be a part of a professional development organization in early childhood. And if you're not, then you are limited to what you know. And you're limited in what's happening too, not just in our community, but in our world, in our states. When we talk about funding and availability to certain areas, you know, even on the education side, scholarship opportunities and childcare for teachers that have kids but want to go to school and can't, you know, looking in grants and grant funding and things of that, that sort, because someone has made that information available to you. So I think it's an inner and outer approach to grow into the ability to advocate in a way where you are confident in what you're saying. And I think there are three words that I always say at the root of that: know your stuff. Know your stuff. Don't start talking about something that you don't know about. Mm-hmm. Know your stuff. If you don't know, it's okay to say, I don't, but I can get that information for you. It's okay to say that. I think that's kind of sometimes where we get confused and we get overwhelmed, because we're trying to talk about something that we know nothing about. And that's okay that you don't know. But if you are intentional, take the time to research and read that information so that you can give that information professionally and in the right way. But if you don't know, you know, and you feel like, you know, you need to get more information, this is when we get back into the training and the education, because now you have at least, you know, credentials and training and support and resources and a portfolio that's going to line up with what you're doing in that classroom, specifically focusing on those age groups. And so when a parent asks you, can you tell me what my child learns by playing with puzzles? Every time I pick my child up, they're playing with puzzles. Can you tell me what my child is learning by playing with puzzles? Well, one that is not quite trained in the field will say, because they like them.
Right.
And one who is trained in the field can give you specific areas of development that are focused on when a child is playing with the puzzle, that the parent may not even know takes place, because all they just see is them putting the puzzle together. But they are not understanding that there are areas of development that should be focused when we talk about the whole child development. It's something that you have to inform your parents about. But if you don't know, your answer will be because they like them. And then you return that with, and that'll be another $500 or more a week. You know, and I'm like, I don't want to pay that for you to just tell me because they like them. So you mean to tell me for $500 a week or more, car note, insurance, whatever you got, to tell me that because they like them, that's all you have for me? that's all you have. And so it's something that, again, our leadership has to make sure our teachers are equipped for these conversations for parents that will ask these questions.
And I really appreciated your comment in terms of, as educators, they don't realize that they're already advocating for the children, mm-hmm. and the families. And so really thinking about, I think the word advocate or advocacy scares people, because they think about it being, oh, you know, I'm going to Capitol Hill, I'm going to City Hall, as opposed to, hey, I have this group of children, I have these families, and there might be some services or things that, you know, they need within our small classroom, our small community, and thinking about how you reach out, you know, thinking about some of the resources that you can, you know, have ready for parents who might ask, you know, or families who might ask a question. So I think you're right, you know, when you think about the leadership is really getting the educators in your program to think about what advocacy means and the different tiers and levels of advocacy. And it leads back to our earlier about the passion for that person. What is your vision? Where are you trying to go? Where are you trying to move in your career? And you take those baby steps as it relates to that. So thank you. As we know, the early childhood field never remains static. And as professionals, new research in pedagogy, child development, psychology, trauma research, and more should inform our practice. The essentials really incorporates contemporary research theory and practice in each successive edition that we publish. But for those who earned their CDA a while ago or who have not read Essentials, what do you see as an important shift taking place in early childhood community right now?
I think connected to COVID, this is my answer is connected to COVID, a more awareness of the need for quality. Mm. This is not to say it wasn't already there, but there is a more direct understanding of the need for quality. So here in Alabama, we have the Alabama First Class Pre-K program, which is a preschool program that is statewide, so children can enter at the age of four. And as we know, when we talk about the age of four, that is in our birth to five group, where we know usually it can just be said the minimal is accepted, right? But what this program has catapulted the understanding that you will have to have a minimum of a CDA to teach for us. You can't just come in here because I love the children. You must have a minimum of a CDA. Programs like that, and I think also leaderships who have changed their standards of what they consider to be quality when they hire, and also holding their teachers accountable for that, has enhanced the desire of students and future students, those that have gotten their CDA and wanted to continue, like some of us have, or not have gotten their CDA at all, to understand that you must keep going. Mm-hmm. You must keep going in order to be as effective as you desire to be in whatever role you're talking about that you want to pursue in the field. There is no way around it. There are no shortcuts. You must take, as you stated, those baby steps to get there. College has no timeline. So as I tell people, take your time, but just know that until you complete this task, you remain where you are. It's simple. You want to move, finish it, you know, and that's the way it has to be. But understand that, take your time in the process. Now, one of the things that, you know, I always talk to our students about is knowing that when you talk about your short and long-term goals, you know, you need to know that each of those goals are connected to some form of training or education in some way. So you must be open to taking those steps to get there. I think that we are collectively starting to understand that this is something that we're going to need to do if we want to see a shift for the better 10 years from now. For me, I feel as though when I served as a director, and I've been a director many times, so I've done the private, the public, the Christian, all of that. But one of the things that I remember particularly in one specific place, and this is before even, I mean, this is a long time ago. One of the things that I said to my teachers, if I hire you and you don't have a CDA, you have 1 year to get it. This was not negotiable because we are not going to have anyone here that is not going to be able to speak professionally to the profession. And this was before power to the profession. This was something that I was speaking before I knew this would even come to be. And I think that leadership needs to not be so quick. And I'm not saying that all leadership is this way. That is not what I'm saying at all. There are some that are quick to say, we just need to hire. We need to fill the spots. But we're not holding them accountable to their growth in their education of the field. And I'm not just talking about the required training hours that DHR says we have to have to maintain our licensure. I'm speaking of additional training and education that helps to make us more effective in the classroom. I do believe that we're starting to see, especially at our college, because we have a portal where employers can submit to us requests for teachers to come and serve at their facility. And they're starting to see now that we should target those that are actually studying this. So So our jobs available tab has grown by leaps and bounds because they're starting to see that you actually have students that actually have to complete field experiences in every child development course, 135-hour practicums, and 149 if they're doing administration. They actually have to go through the NAICS standard practices and implementation just to graduate. We even have a CDA mentorship program where we take in a minimum of 10 to 20 students per year. And those students basically almost kind of like sit up under my armpit, if you want, you know, because they're with me this whole time. I'm really every step of the way. The goal is to get them through the education component that we offer. But then when they finish, some of them struggle with what happens when I finish the education component. Mm-hmm. Should the CDA be coming in the mail next week, Dr. Shackelford? I've been checking and I have to tell them that was just step one, dear. Now we must complete the required employment hours, your questionnaires that go to your families. You have to schedule a PD specialist to come out. You know, you have to take the CDA exam. You know, there are many that don't have the intentionality to figure this out on their own. And so we look to see how can we create a group where we can target that so that as we see this shift where there's more of a desire now, there are people now that are more preferring CDA minimum of their employees, we can give you that. Ours are coming out with beyond, you know, they're having degrees and et cetera. But when we talk about the minimum of the CDA, our mission, like a part of our whole program, is to ensure that we're cranking out students that graduate with CDAs, basic certificates, advanced certificates, and degrees when they walk across that stage, so that they are fully ready to go. So I think that the shift is more so just now understanding that you're going to have to have quality in your facility if you want it to be quality. Quality starts with the people that provide it. So how mm-hmm. can I provide quality if I don't even know what that means? I'm accountable for that. And leadership has to decide. They have to make a decision about, are you going to intentionally seek that up front or give them some type of leeway like I did? You know, or what will you do to ensure that you have that? Because at the end of the day, the child's engagement and the family engagement is going to be with your team that's in those classrooms. You know, families walk in the past when I served as the director, they walk in, you know, good morning, you know, Miss Cindy, you know, and I talk to them, I have chocolate for them and coffee and all the treats, you know, and some of them come to pick up their kids and sit in my office and have a snack before they go. You know, I remember these memories, but at the end of the day, if their engagement was not right with those teachers, mm-hmm. the family would leave.
Right.
They would leave. It's because my relationship with them is my relationship, but my child is with that teacher or group of teachers. You are accountable for telling me about how my child is developing every day. You are accountable for telling me what developmental milestones my child has met. And when I ask to meet with you, that you should have information that you have, you know, observed and documented, because you should be observing every day, even if it's just small anecdotal records. You should be equipped and ready to speak to me about my child. And you should be able to, as we said, professionally and in confidence, talk to me about how my child is doing. So I'm starting to see a change just in more, even on the student side. We're having more students to say, Dr. Shackelford, I want to get my CDA. Can you help me in what I need to do? I now see that I can't be hired here. They won't hire me if I don't have a CDA. So what do I do? They see now that there's no way around. You cannot say birth to five is important, but you don't want quality in your classroom? I don't understand. So there's a big change in that. And I'm hoping to see, and I think that's a part of another root of why I push the way that I do. My hope is to see that we have quality from birth to forever, you know, in our classrooms for these children. You know, it's not about whether or not a parent has to put their child in childcare, it doesn't matter their reason for their why of them being there. The point is, you're supposed to be the next best group of people to the parent. Mm-hmm. And if you're not that, tell me why you're not, because they shouldn't be there and neither should you. You know, so there's a lot of pieces to that. I think that we have miles to go with that, but I'm starting to see just an uptick in the desire of wanting our students, because they know our students are coming out with it. So we're getting a lot of inquiries to our college, in our department, a lot of emails asking for our students intentionally, because they know we target the CDA. It's on our degree checklist. You know how some degree checklists don't even have that, but our degree checklist actually has a section for CDA candidates so that they can know these are the courses you're going to need towards your CDA. We're going to help you. You desire to teach in, say, the Alabama First Class Pre-K program. You desire to teach with this particular organization that says you have to have these number of credit hours. This is what we're here to do to help you to get that. So that shift is now on both sides, the desire to receive it and the desire to seek those that have it, instead of just saying, well, you meet the minimum and we'll just hire you to fill the spot. It doesn't work.
Dr. Shackelford, I want to say thank you so much for joining in this conversation. I have enjoyed your responses to the questions. Any last thoughts as we wrap up for today, or any special projects or publications you're working on that you'd like to share, you know, with those who are watching and listening about?
Sure. My thoughts in regards to intentional educators is that we are equipped. We are equipped. We already have the tools to be effective in the classroom when we know we've been called to teach. And this is specifically for the ones that have been called to teach, because that's the only ones that are supposed to be in the classroom. Mm-hmm. But in that, we have an accountability to build upon what we know, to continue to research information to help make us better, no matter the level that we teach. But when we are focusing on our birth to five age group, we need to be intentional about our continuing research and training and information so that we can be effective and change with the changes, because it changes every day. We need to be able to change with the changes. In order to do that, we have to be equipped and use the equipment that we have, our tools that we've already been given, to sharpen them and make sure that they're not rusty and make sure that they're clean and, you know, ready to be used, you know, over and over again, but now they work better than they did before, because we're continuing to keep them current. And that's what our knowledge in education is, continuing to keep it current so that we can change with the changes and be ready for the way that information is received. That is what we're accountable for. I'm currently doing a lot of reading and research. It's, again, you know, you're asking me questions where information is right here in my feet. So one of the things that I actually, believe it or not, I currently have sitting here is a CDA credential booklet. I'm helping a couple of students right now that are wanting to get their CDA, and they've completed the education component and they're needing some mentorship. So I'm helping them, and they're in infant toddler. So I'm working with them. And so when we meet virtually, I have them to have their book and I have my book, turn to page so-and-so, you know, that's one of the things I'm currently doing. Actually, I have scheduled that today. I'm currently also working on implementation of our Alabama standards for early learning development. This is something I'm kind of working on right now to implement that into our coursework. This is an updated version. And so I just received this from the supervisor of the department in Montgomery. So I'm going to be utilizing that. Writing wise, I'm actually writing a book called Thoughts of an Educator. This book probably will not be published until 2022, because I wanted to actually allow other educators to speak to it. At first it was all of me speaking, and then I said, no, there are others that I know that have things to say. And so I'm actually soliciting educators to speak to that. And I'm currently actually also, because I just love all things education, working on a report focusing on dual enrollment for online learners with learning disabilities. I am trying to look to find recommendations to help students who are struggling with learning disabilities for online learning. I noticed this issue when we began implementing online versions of our courses in child development in our high schools. Our college has a partnership with 60 high schools and counting. And so in the dual enrollment program, you know, we offer the opportunity for our students to get their basic certificate. So they graduate with their high school diploma and a basic certificate and or their CDA. And as we know, the council just released the high school program for CDA programs as well. And so I have a partnership with two specifically that are going to implement that. And so we're looking to just make sure that no matter who decides to go that route, that there are recommendations put in place to be sure that we cross all T's and dot all I's when we meet in the middle with our high schools. There's sometimes information that they have that we may not be aware of on the higher ed side that we need to know so that we can effectively teach the children when we talk about those accommodations. So that's something I'm working on, or a few of the things I'm working on right now.
Just a few
things I'm working on, not much at all. So yeah, I don't have much to do, I don't. So yes, but that's all I have. I'm so grateful that you guys allowed me to speak today. Again, the council is near and dear to my heart. It is connected to me and forever be rooted in what I do. And I'm just so grateful to be where I am. Again, I have miles to go, but I think about all of those that have touched my life through my career and have poured into me. And as we talked about, feedback, good, bad, and ugly, helped me to grow, to know what to do, what not to do. The self-reflection piece, you know, all of these things are connected. I am a Christian, so I do believe I was born with a purpose that was given to me by God that no one else can take away. And I think I'm accountable for honing in on that and growing from that purpose. And so I just thank you for your time.
Thank you again. I appreciate it. And a key thing, having that competency standards book. I have, you know, those next to me. I also have the essentials. I've got flags in here, all that good stuff.
Yes.
Thank you again for your time. It's been a wonderful conversation. I'd like to thank our audience for tuning in, and I hope that, you know, they're able to walk away with a lot of tidbits and just things to help just, you know, percolate in their thoughts and things of that nature. So thank you, and thank you. Are signing off, saying goodbye.
Goodbye, everyone. Thank you so much. Have a great day.